It was wonderful.
Thank you.
Yes. It's an amazing piece, this old castle. You like old castles?
Very much. But especially when it's illustrated with music, mm-hmm. it's even more beautiful. Because there's lots of moments of silence in this music. There's lots of repetitive moments, like perpetual movement, which is the symbol of something which never ends. State of spirit of the old castle is something that has no time. We don't know when did really start to exist. So there is this moment of existence, always existence. But on the other hand, there is painful chords in the right hand, which shows that still old castle has this painful feeling that maybe one day it maybe not exist anymore. So there's this pain of disappearing, which is, I think, pain of also human beings in general. Mm-hmm. We're all sometimes scared and sometimes sad that we might disappear or somebody might disappear.
Did you analyze all the pictures this way or?
Oh, definitely.
Oh, really?
All the pieces okay. I record usually has a very important and personal but also important ideological or just an idea meaning, because otherwise I would not record something, as for me an album represents not only music, just interpretation, musical interpretation, but music expresses lots of things. Music has this capacity of being much wider thing than just beautiful sounds. It can be sometimes painful, tragic, or ugly even, or you know, there are so many emotions that music can express, so many stories that music can express. And also Liszt, for example, was always saying that music can express architecture with scales, different scales. You can show different shapes of architecture, or it can describe nature or human psycho-emotional portrayal of a human being, or simply a story. So album for me is a story that I'm telling through music that inspired me.
Okay. And that's a kaleidoscope.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's dark.
And it's dark.
It's dark because music gonna add colors on it. Because I think this music, all three pieces which I recorded, which is Ravel, Laval's, Stravinsky, Petrushka, mm-hmm. and Mussorgsky pictures at the exhibition, all of them has quite, dark reality. These are snippets of dark reality, which through music we transform in something very colorful. In general, also, for example, not only if we don't talk about music, but about the story of each piece, has something which is quite tragic, but if not tragic, sometimes complex. Let's say Petrushka, for example, it's a fairy tale for kids. It's a marionette theater. So it should be something very joyful. And there are moments of being joyful, but also there are moments when the main hero, which is Petrushka, is dead at the end. So it's a fairy tale, but the basis, the you know, basic story of it is quite tragic. So that's why it's dark, because this is the basis, and on it music just brings so many colors. Mm. And
what is the story behind this pictures at an exhibition? Because it's a tribute, huh, to a friend of Mussorgsky.
Yeah. I think Mussorgsky's pictures at the exhibition is one of those few pieces, like, for example, Liszt Sonata, which I recorded on my mm-hmm. first album, which gives you possibility to find your own interpretation and understanding of the piece and to dig much deeper and to find things that maybe it was not imagined before, or maybe it was, or in different direction. So this piece is a very personal piece for me, because I know there is orchestra version by Ravel, but I always preferred piano version, because when you go to the museum, you want to get these emotions, you personal it. This promenade is a very intimate process of marche, like marching, right?
And you took a very, very beautiful tempo. Thank you.
But it's not something for me which is pathetic or just look at me, I'm just marching in a museum to see. No, promenade is something that a person who goes to the museum wants to discover emotions through these pictures we are seeing. So it stays always personal. So orchestra cannot show this intimate process of observing something as well as piano, as an instrument. So there is this moment of promenade, which is observer, which gonna receive the emotions through the pictures. And then there is stories that is by creator presented to impress you or to fascinate you or to touch you or to move you. But first promenade for me is a period of a human being's life when, with the experience, one thinks that cannot be astonished anymore by life, which is symbolically metaphored in pictures. So First Promenade is skeptical, not cynical, but it's definitely skeptical because you think you won't be moved or touched. You're gonna stay as skeptical as you were before entering the museum.
But afterwards, can you show that?
Yeah, of course. So there's some kind of solitude which is expressed in only one voice. Mm-hmm. Later, when we meet the same theme, it's in two voices, the same tonality, but with two voices. First one is. So it's more about thought rather than action. It's a thought which is skeptical. Afterwards, when Gnomus already, which is first picture, inspires and still, even if the person who was entering the museum was skeptical, still was touched, the promenade process transforms each time when you hear it, for example. Second time, it's already. There is more astonishment and more kind of warm feeling, which is actually accepting that I might be touched by something still. And then there is this joyful promenade, which shows that I'm so happy, I can feel something, I'm still alive. Then this mesmerizing, very subtle and like fairy tale kind of sound. And then comes again the same theme as in the beginning, in the same tonality, but with more convict, how can I say, when you are more sure of what is existing is real, and it's not anymore so related with solitude, because it's in two voices, he expresses then in two voices. And so on. And at the end, what is very beautiful is that promenade and the piece, picture, are already together. It's both together. It's like creator and observer are the same person.
Ravel orchestrated this piece, mm-hmm. and maybe it's more well known than the piano version, but did you use the score for inspiration for maybe the sound or what?
I did not.
Good.
Because I think in Stravinsky, yes, because I first played this piece in the orchestra, and it's an orchestral piece, and then it was arranged for the piano. So definitely in Stravinsky, for me, the main challenge was to express this orchestral sound. But in Mussorgsky's pictures, as it originally was written for the piano, and as I appreciate and my perception of this piece is more personal, stays related with the capacity of the piano, which is very rich, but still it's like mono instrument. It can show lots of colors, but it still stays mono instrument. And what is interesting in these sounds of the piano that you can discover in this piece is that volume is from like four piano until, you know, forte, and it's unendless and unlimited. But also when it's, for example, fortissimo, two fortissimos might sound different. There is fortissimo, which is aggressive, for example, or like satirical and a little bit ridiculous, like. And then there is more kind of, how can I say, grateful and long sound and large sound and something that's very generous, like you're giving without thinking how much you receive. It's like. Just create the sound. So it shows how rich piano can be. So definitely I wasn't looking for orchestral sounds. I was looking how rich and complex piano sound might be.
Okay. You started rather young, at three years old, mm-hmm. when you started. What was in your head, not when you were 3 years old, but when you become older, was all these kind of extremities already in your imagination, or how music should sound, mm-hmm. or?
Definitely, yes. At 3 years old I started, but it was like playing games start. It was not serious start. Like playing really pieces, it started with 5, 6 years old. But definitely, you said you're a pianist of extremity, yes, but also when you have these extreme moments, you appreciate more this golden edge, which is also very important to me. But there is no sense of golden edge if there are no extreme moments, and everything has more importance when you have also dark sides. It's like light will not have an importance if there will be no dark. So if I don't have this extreme losing myself moments, I will not find myself as well. And it's same thing about music. If I don't go really far in places, in the dark places I've never imagined, I cannot find the beauty of simplicity in the music as well. So I like mixing all these things because I think music is very rich.
Yes, and because music you can, in a way.
Thank
because
you.
You're
so
technical,
it's a product of human being, music. It's not, it didn't jump from heaven. It's a product of human being, and human being is very complex, and it cannot be so represented in the same manner always. It's impossible.
Yeah, but you need to have the technique also to do it.
That's true.
Actually.
That's the only reason why technique is good to have. Otherwise, we don't need it at all.
At all.
But if it helps you to, you know, go very far in thoughts you have, you might have around the music, then of course technique gives a lot of help.
Okay, wonderful CD.
Thank you.
Really, the Mussorgsky is really refreshing.
Thank you. Thank you very much.